Hello everybody, I'm Lisa Segura, for those of you who don't know me. And I'm going to be following on Maggie's fantastic talk with a particular focus on issues in online interviewing. Although there will be some sort of parallels, I'm quite pleased to note as well, specifically in the sort of areas of disclosures and things like that online. Okay, so currently I'm a teaching fellow here at Southampton, and I'll be talking about my my PhD research in particular, one of the studies that I conducted. So my PhD is in web science, and this is based here in Southampton and conducts research into the impact of society on the web and vice versa. And it's really at the very sort of cutting edge of digital and online research. And I'm pleased to see that there's a couple of students from web science here today as well. So my PhD is very interdisciplinary. So it looked at, it combined criminology, law, health sciences and computer science to look at the contemporary issue of purchasing pharmaceuticals online. So specifically, how and why are people buying medicine, particularly prescription medicine, from the web? So as my research was concerned with web users, I utilised online methods in my studies. Combining a mixed methods approach, I undertook observations of online forums, an online survey, and online interviews, although I did also conduct some face-to-face interviews as well. Today I'm going to concentrate on the area of online interviewing and tell you about some of the unexpected issues and mishaps that I encountered, and reflect upon what I have learnt from my experiences, but first I'll discuss some background context to online interviews. So firstly, why undertake online interviews? In the first instance, before deciding whether or not to undertake them, there's some useful considerations. So it's very obvious in my research, with its focus on the web and web users, that online methods would be the most beneficial. And in order to obtain a qualitative understanding of the issue, so namely, why are people purchasing medicine from the web, online interviews were necessary. So this covered the sort of who you want in the study and where you're going to find them. I really wanted to access web users and, of course, the sample group that obviously we then found online. However, other factors also influenced my decisions. So noting the difference between researching the web and web research was something that I had to think about. With research in the web, you know, this would just involve researching online and research which examines the web and web and in comparison, you've got web research, which is online methods and research which uses the web to undertake research. So my work involved the former, research in the web. I was interested in a web issue and used online methods to investigate it. So web research, in contrast, can be used to undertake studies that involve offline issues. And for example, online interviews can be conducted with participants about a subject that is not necessarily to do with the web, just that it's possibly the most convenient way to undertake that interview. And of course, with web users, you know, you need to think about their experience and attitudes towards using technology. So in either case, whether or not you're undertaking web research or research using the web, your participants' technological experience and their attitudes towards using technology, you know, is really paramount. You know, there's no point considering using online interviews if people are, you know, if your participants are technophobes or, you know, they're not even familiar with using the web. So Geiser and Schreiner also suggest that the researcher should be mindful of the types of technologies that participants are more likely to use. So are your participants, you know, more frequent PC users, mobile phone users, they use tablets? You know, this could affect the method of online interview that you use. So hence for me, it was very important that I gave my participants the freedom to choose the mode of interview that was best for them. So moving on to the types of online interview methods that I looked at, so specifically email, instant messenger, and Skype video chat. Aside from email interviews, you can see that some parallels may be made between online interviews and the more traditional methods of offline interviewing. So in the first instance, it's very difficult to try and compare email interviews with previous offline methods. So, for example, they're far too removed from the self-completion questionnaire, post that you know be sent out postally, for example. You know, the communication with an email interview, you know, it's bi-directional, the interviewer can direct the interview, as well as respond to new and interesting information revealed in the conversation. Therefore, I argue that email interviewing is subject to new considerations and researchers need to prepare differently before undertaking this method of interview. But I'll talk a little bit more about that later on in this presentation. And distinctions may be drawn between instant messaging interviews and telephone interviews. For example, they're both conducted in real time, with the interviewer and the interviewee sharing the same time, though it's not in the same space. And there are a wealth of different companies online that provide instant messaging services on the web. And familiarising yourself with whichever one you are going to use in your interviews is always beneficial. Of course, a main difference between telephone interviews and instant messaging interviews is that with instant messaging interviews, you get an automatic transcript of the conversation. With telephone interviews, you have to use some form of recording software and then type up the interview afterwards, which is extremely time-consuming. So some academics have sort of been discussing these sorts of issues. Garbutt and McCormack in particular discussed how telephone interviews have been criticised for their absence of visual cues. And the same criticism can be directed against instant messaging interviews. In Skype video interviews, the researcher and the interviewee benefit from being able to read the other's body language. According to James and Busher, the inclusion of both verbal and non-verbal cues, such as facial expressions, gestures, postures, and emotional mannerisms in face-to-face interviews, enhance the social interaction. The immediacy of social presence taking place in real time is a pivotal part of the research relationship. So overall, there are key issues to consider before conducting any research interviews, and these also apply to online interviewing. So first of all, verbal and non-verbal cues, you know, whether or not they're visual, or physical, is it typed or spoken words, you know, could these impact on how to respond to the participant? And the immediacy of social presence. So in face-to-face interviews and Skype videos, video interviews, you can see each other. You're more conscious of your gestures and behaviour. With instant messenger and telephone, there's no visual cues. So they, and of course yourself as the researcher, could be distracted by other things going on all around you. So with real time, whether the conversation is occurring instantaneously, so is it asynchronous or synchronous? Now, this point I found to be extremely important within my work, and I'll elaborate more about this on the next slide. With sensitive information, Henson et al. Suggested that although the face-to-face method might facilitate openness, participants might be subtly induced to untrue admissions, whilst telephone participants have been described by Novick as relaxed and willing to talk freely and discuss intimate information. So, do perceptions of anonymity enable participants to divulge more, especially when the information is sensitive? So if this were the case, then perhaps email and instant messenger interviews would be more useful than Skype video interviews in research projects involving sensitive issues. Or perhaps it's not necessarily as clear-cut as that. Well, Johnson claims that the semi-anonymity of online communications encourages people to self-disclose more than it hinders them from doing so. So with time, interviews conducted in real time, such as Skype video and instant messenger, you are constrained by time just as you are with telephone interviews and face-to-face interviews. Obviously, with email interviews, you can respond wherever and whenever, even whilst mobile. And then similarly with location, whilst location is a hugely significant factor in face-to-face interviewing and telephone interviewing, especially if you don't want to run up costly international phone bills, for example, you know, the beauty of the web is that geographical boundaries are insignificant and you're able to converse with people the other side of the world for free, well, obviously apart from the cost of things like broadband and electricity and Wi-Fi and so on. But this obviously opens up the potential for your sample group. And although this is undoubtedly a massive, you know, a massive positive in research, there are some challenges as well that can be easily overlooked. With interview fatigue, in any interview, it is possible for the conversation to run out of steam, especially if it's going on for a long time. Email interviews in particular can avoid this, as participants can take their time in answering and are not being continually deluged with questions. And again, it's easy to just look at the positives in this sort of situation and not consider some of the issues that might arise. Obviously, with transcribing, you know, how to record and transcribe your interview is obviously a major consideration. You know, it's very, very easy with Instant Messenger and emails, as automatic records of the conversations are generated. With Skype, there are programs that can record the conversation, usually for a fee, but obviously you're still going to have to type up and transcribe. Obviously, you can do the old-fashioned way of audio recording, using a tape recorder as you would during face-to-face interviews, and again, type it up afterwards. Obviously, time-consuming. Of course, if you had a video message, or if you had the video message, or if you had the audio recording, it would make a difference of whether or not you've got the ability to analyse visual cues. But of course, that would necessarily depend on, you know, whether or not you feel that's intrinsic to your research. And of course, technological problems. So just like tape recorders not working properly offline in your interviews, there are lots and lots of technological issues that can occur. So network errors, Wi-Fi, broadband access, all sorts of issues. And of course, these can all cause major headaches when trying to conduct online interviews. So of course, I just want to go back to discussing the sort of temporal issues. And want to briefly focus on the distinctions between whether an interview is asynchronous or synchronous. So asynchronous interviews, such as email interviews, are not conducted in real time. So participants are able to reread what they have previously written, reflect on and consider their responses and amend their text. Interviews are not restricted to a set time, so it can take place over several days or even longer. This may increase the potential of collecting in-depth, rich data. In contrast, synchronous interviews such as Instant Messenger or Skype video responses are spontaneous. These are constrained by time and involve the interaction and sharing of experiences. And these are framed by both the researcher and the participant's online presence. So Jennifer Markham has highlighted how there has been considerable debate about the reflexive nature of the online medium. Asynchronous email discussions can allow for an extended and deliberate sequence of conversations and enable researchers and participants to digest messages before replying. And Kivitz states that participants have the time and space to refine their own thinking without intrusion by the visual presence of the researcher, which allows the development of a more thoughtful and personal form of communication. In accordance, Boker and Tuffin also note that the ability of participants to reflect on their thoughts and reactions can be enhanced as a result of the intimacy furthered by the informality of typing. So I'm now going to move on to focus specifically on my PhD research, having given sort of background context. So for my PhD, I conducted 28 interviews over 4 months. These involved experiences of healthcare and purchasing medicines online, and I recruited interview participants from my online survey via word of mouth, snowball techniques, and using existing networks and social media. This study mediated between the virtual field and the real field by combining online and offline interactions and communication in the different methods of interviewing employed. These included more traditional means, such as face-to-face and telephone interviews, but also innovative techniques benefiting from the contemporary technologies I've been discussing, like Instant Messenger, Skype video messaging, and email. As I've already pointed out, some online techniques are not dissimilar to their offline counterparts. I certainly found that face-to-face interviewing is comparable with Skype video interviews, as both the researcher and the participant can observe body language and respond accordingly, whilst instant messaging, telephone interviews and email interviews obviously do not benefit from such a physical presence. I generally found that face-to-face methods procured a larger amount of data than email interviews, and these tended to encourage sort of very short, focused answers. However, I was able to return to the email conversations and resume questions if I felt that the data needed to be elaborated on. Now, this wasn't possible with the face-to-face interviews because these were usually under sort of time constraints. With one of my participants, whose chosen method of interview was instant messaging in an encrypted chat room, I was able to keep resuming the interview over 5 separate occasions. This is because on each occasion we had a very limited time to talk, but luckily we'd built up a relationship whereby the participant was happy for me to keep talking with him. So by using different interviewing methods, valuable data were collected from people who may otherwise have not been able to participate. And the techniques were tailored to their needs. So instant messaging and email interviewing avoided interview fatigue, as well as concerns about my safety as a researcher, and increased the geographical reach of the research. So I'm now going to address each online method in turn and talk about some of the experiences that I encountered. So starting with email interviews. So I encourage participants to review their previous correspondences and to revisit earlier topics in order to help the development of their thinking about other issues. I return participants' messages to them as part of the normal email exchange, so I kept the thread of email messages rather than starting each email anew. I did not erase any messages from the exchange in order to ensure that the participants and I were able to interrogate earlier texts as our dialogues developed. As mentioned earlier, with email interviews, participants are able to answer at times convenient to them. This led to sometimes large gaps and lapses in the dialogue. And at the beginning, I sort of started to panic, thinking that people weren't sort of continuing with the research and they weren't getting back to me. But actually, over the course of the interviews, my attitude sort of changed. Towards having to wait for responses. It sort of changed from being, from trepidation and concern that they'd lost interest to actually the anticipation of and the possibility of obtaining exciting and new information. Because actually it seemed that the longer they took to come back, the more sort of rich and valuable the data would be, because they'd actually give me longer answers. So as Russell and Bullock put it ever so succinctly, one of the beauties of email is that you never know when you'll get a response. However, there were some very sort of specific challenges, which seem very simplistic with hindsight, that I had to deal with. So I don't know if we can all sort of read this. I'll explain the context of this email thread, but apologies, it needs to be read from bottom to top, just like an email exchange would be. So I'll tell you the sort of story behind this. I had been conducting an email interview with this particular participant over the duration of a couple of days. And the responses had been very sporadic. So there'd been some sort of communication in the middle of the day, and then there'd be other sort of coming up very random times, such as late at night, early hours of the morning. And often I wouldn't actually see some of those random responses coming in because I was asleep, which I know is very sort of rare for an academic, but managed to get some sleep during my PhD. However, if I did see an email sent very late at night, I took it upon myself not to answer straight back, thinking that I didn't want to inconvenience the participant by trying to continue the interview and the dialogue, through the night. This was a complete error on my part, as obviously miscommunication had occurred between ourselves. Firstly, though I had said from the outset that the participant could take their time in replying to me, I had not clarified that in return my responses would not be instantaneous either. Therefore, when the participant was answering my questions, they expected me to be answering them back straight away and continuing with the interview immediately, regardless of the time. Also, this was also problematic in other scenarios as well, when this was people, I'd spoke with people that were in America or the other side of the world, for example. So it seems like a very sort of basic consideration, but one I managed to overlook. So I was also unaware that the participant was working shifts, and so the unsociable hours, suit them better, to continue with the interview. As you can see then, this led to them almost terminating the interview, on the basis of them thinking that I wasn't bothered. So the particular email was sent when I was asleep. And so upon waking and seeing that email, and yes, I'm the type of person that when I wake up, the first thing I do is check my emails on my phone. So of course I got this email through and panicked. So I hastily wrote an apologetic email and the reply on my phone. You know, such was the immediacy of importance of obviously trying to keep this participant engaged. And of course, one of the very big positives of email interviewing is that you can, you know, obviously you can just do it straight away on your phone. And of course, luckily, very fortunately, I was able to placate the participant and continue with the interview. So for myself, a major lesson was learnt here about the importance of communication and managing expectations between the researcher and the participant. So moving on to instant messaging interviews, I use Skype and CryptoChat. So CryptoChat, has anybody heard about CryptoChat? No? Okay, I hadn't heard about it either before my interviews either. So it's an encrypted chat room. So it's basically, you might have heard some things in the news recently about David Cameron trying to get security access to anything encrypted. So yeah, basically encryption, you know, so obviously it can't be accessed, right? So that's sort of anonymity, privacy context. So basically you download this CryptoChat software onto your computer, and you have a password then to talk to specific people, and you can only speak one-on-one. After you finish speaking, the conversation automatically disappears. So what I would do, I'd cut and paste the interview into a Word document to keep a transcript at the end of the interview. Although there was one mortifying occasion when I accidentally hit the end button and lost the whole hour's interview. Luckily, this was the participant that I could keep going back and forth with, you know, over, I think it was like 5 times. So fortunately, I was able to continue a conversation with that participant at a later date and sort of cover much of the same content that I had lost. And I didn't actually divulge to the participant, you know, the silly error that I had made, but I managed to get most of the information back, luckily. So it was the participant that actually obviously suggested this software. They were very, very anxious about our conversations being intercepted. This is because they needed to be assured of anonymity. They were divulging information sort of about illegal drug use and the use of illegal underground websites. You can understand why they were a little bit sensitive, perhaps. I felt that conducting instant messaging interviews did feel similar to conducting a telephone interview. Although there were differences in pauses and reactions, when you're speaking with somebody on instant messaging, you can see the dots, you can see that they're actually writing. You know, you can compare that perhaps with a telephone conversation with somebody going, reassurances that they're still there. But you wouldn't necessarily, when somebody is writing, do that sort of communication back and forth with each other. That would just seem very artificial and very, very odd. So there are obviously some very sort of verbal and textual differences between instant messaging and telephone interviewing. You know, you wouldn't want to disrupt the flow when somebody's writing, but if somebody is speaking, you know, you might do sort of acknowledgements verbally. Of course, where there's silence at the end of the phone or no visible reaction on screen for a long time, it's also very easy to get disconcerted again and start thinking that they're not writing, they're not there, and you want to sort of prompt them. So this is really where patience is key, and you need to allow the participant the time to think. So finally, I'm just going to quickly talk about one of my experiences with my Skype interviews. I expected the particular topic that I'm researching, obviously it's quite sensitive, I expected it might prevent some interviewees from revealing details about their private lives or health experiences. However, this wasn't actually the case, and certainly with the Skype interviews. So in this example with Kurt, so Kurt had ticked the box on the survey stating that he'd never bought medicine from the web. However, he readily confessed to the opposite at the beginning of the Skype interview. So I could see his apologetic expression visibly straight away when he said at the very outset of the interview, you know, I have bought medicine, and then he justified his reasons for not being honest about his behaviour from the outset. So Kurt spoke about using the web to purchase synthetic cannabinoids, which are research chemicals that mimic the effects of cannabis. He stated that the reason he bought them was to treat his depression and anxiety, and he viewed these substances as medicinal treatments, though they're not legally available on prescription. So he appeared to have deliberately withheld his purchasing in his responses on the online survey I conducted. And these contradictions perhaps point to a design flaw in my survey, or perhaps there should have been a clearer definition from the outset to avoid any confusion. However, Kurt's apology and then subsequent account suggests that some respondents may feel more comfortable disclosing such sensitive information than in survey form. It was very interesting that obviously he felt comfortable to be contacted for an interview and to be open about his behaviour in person. So this could suggest a difference in the way interviews are perceived by participants compared with surveys, for example. And according to Pew, interviews can reveal emotional dimensions of social experience not evident in other methods. So this may suggest that there are private and public perceptions between methods which are only identifiable through the use of mixed methods. So I think that's another really important consideration to have when using online methods as well, that obviously if you want to get a more holistic picture, obviously mixed methods are the way to go. But bringing it back to the context of this talk, you know, the interesting question for me is whether or not there's something different about online interviews and the responses that possibly new methods encourage. So is Skype interviewing a novel way of conducting face-to-face interviews, you know, that encourages more disclosures? Okay, so to conclude, with email interviewing, in my experience, I found it to be a distinct online method. However, it was very easy to overlook very simple and basic details. With instant messaging interviewing, I found that it is comparable with telephone interviewing, but there are subtle differences in perceptions and reactions, specifically with whether or not something is textual or verbal. And with Skype video interviewing, again, I found it comparable to sort of traditional offline methods, you know, specifically face-to-face interviewing, yet it potentially enables the disclosures of new information, but is this because it's a more relaxed setting, you know, obviously people in the comfort of their own home with a barrier, you know, the barrier of the computer screen behind, so obviously distancing the researcher and the participant. So the very last point that I'd like to make is to question to what extent should we as researchers prepare differently for these types of interviews? And there's some references. Thank you.